Thank you. First of all, I would like to thank Hercules, the organizer. It's a pleasure to be here and to participate to this very, very interesting workshop. Okay, so my title perhaps is a singular point because the word resurgence doesn't appear. Okay, so I will speak of rational Q-difference equation, linear and non-linear. I conjecture the existence of a Q-analog of the wild fundamental group, classifying the rational linear Q-difference equation. Okay. And the local contribution to this group well known. There are some work with collaboration with Soloa and Zhang. So in some sense, the Q resurgence is perfectly understood, I can say. And it's quite analog to, it's very, very similar to the analogy, in some sense, if you understand the thing clearly, the analogy with the resurgence are transparent. But yes, but what paradoxically remains mysterious, in fact, is the Fuchsian contribution of the intermediate singularities. Okay, so we think that the manner of decomposition that I will introduce later, it's a sort of Q analog of the pan decomposition in the topology of surface. We hope that it is the first steps towards the comprehension of this part. Okay, and we hope that, I'm not a physicist, but I hope that it can be useful so in some problems of physics. Okay, so if we look at the Q analog of the classical differential Penleve equation, according to the work of fundamental work of Sakai, everything is perfectly well known on the left side, the side of connection, the left side of the Q analog of Riemann-Hilbert map. That is the Q analog of the Okamoto space of initial condition. But the right side, that is the Q analog of character varieties, remain quite mysterious, and anyway, I don't know works about this side. Okay, so it's natural to begin with P6. So today I will present a description of the character variety of QP6, but it's the beginning of the story, so it's for fixed generic parameters. Usual QP6 is complicated when for special value of parameter and so on. So it will be a story for later. So today I will look fix parameter and generically. As I will explain, in the classical case is a cubic affine cubic surface for differential equation. In that case, in the Q analog is a modified elliptic surface that I will try to describe explicitly, some parametrization. And this in order to do this parametrization, I will use this Mano decomposition. It's a work in progress, not finished, with Yusuke Oyama and Jacques Soloa. Okay, briefly, everybody knows that, I think, but it's perhaps better to precise the notation and so on. So, first of all, I look at the very classical. My lecture is very elementary in some sense. It's the very beginning and for Q analogs. So, I look at the very beginning for the classical case. So, you start for four puncture sphere. you look at this fundamental group, and you look at the representation in SL2C. And of course, you know the representation if you know free matrices. So you can identify with an algebraic variety, and then you quotient by equivalence of representation. Okay, and then you get character variety of the four function sphere. I recall it's better to recall briefly the usual computation. So you describe this variety using free coordinate. In brown, you have the fixed parameter. And then you have x, y, z. Okay, and then these components, these parameters satisfy the quartic equation. And in brown, you have the fixed parameter. Okay, and then if you fix the brown parameter, then you get an affine cubic surface, and here you have the equation. And so you interpret that as a family of affine cubic surface. Okay, and for generic value, it's smooth. Okay, so my purpose, as I repeat, is very elementary. I want to explain what is a Q analog of the surface. I recall that you have a natural Poisson structure on this surface. Unfortunately, I don't understand the Q analog. Okay, so I want a Q analog of the character variety of the four puncture sphere. Of course, there is a natural approach. If you know the fundamental group, the Q fundamental group, you copy the preceding construction. But unfortunately, today, such a group is not known. So I will use an indirect method. I will start from the classical relation between the character variety and the Penleve differential equation P6. And then I will build a Q analog of this thing. Okay, as I explained, it will be the final result will be an algebraic variety in all the in parameters and variables, but today is not the case. Today I will just describe a family. That is, the study of the singular case is missing. In particular, the study of special solution of UP6 is missing because it corresponds to non-generic parameters. Okay, here I recall the P6, the second order linear differential equation. Penleve equation was not discovered by Penleve, but by Richard Fuchs. It's well known that you have four complex parameters. Everybody knows that it has a Penleve property, the moving singularity at the pole. And it was discovered by Richard Fuchs in relation with the problem of isomonodromic deformation. And it is that approach that I will copy for Q difference, in the Q difference case. Okay. Okay, so it's a particular case of the preceding situation. Okay, so I consider the moduli space of connection with fixed local data, the Brown parameters, corresponding to Okamoto space of initial condition, and it is on one side, and the other side of Riemann-Hilbert, the aim of Riemann-Hilbert, you have the character variety, F, this one. And when this one is smooth, so you have an analytic diffeomorphism. Okay, so this is the classical things and then I will try to explain the Q-analogs. Okay. So it's, I will not comment a lot on this slide. You have on the right side, you have a fiber bundle whose fiber are isomorphic to the character variety, and of with a flat Ehrlichman connection, and then if you pull back, you get P6. Okay, so this is the basic idea. Okay, now you know the actors and then the play. So the Riemann-Hilbert correspondence for Fuchsian Q difference equation was introduced by Birkhoff in a famous paper in 1930. The generalized Riemann problem for linear differential equation and the Hallerith problem for linear difference and Q difference equation. So he had been studied later. And we generalize to irregular equation. Okay, so as I explained, I will use as a main tool the work of Jimbo Sakai on QP6. So they discovered that I to obtain a Lax pair for QP6. So they consider a family of Fuchsian systems. That. And then you have this matrix with a parameter T, and they put nice condition. And the basic idea is very simple, extremely, it's a bold step. They consider, they decide that this family is isomodromic if the Birkhoff connection matrix is not constant, but is Q constant. So if mu from T for QT, then you have this equality. Okay, technically they suppose that the eigenvalues of these one is constant and the other is Q constant. This is technical. Okay, and they show that their Q is an isomodromic condition. For this family is equivalent to the existence of Lax pair in this sense, the Q analog, the differential Lax pair. Okay, and then this is the basic case, it is QP6, and later Sakai generalized to other case, and later Murata generalized to a lot of family of system, in particular to irregular systems. Like for classical Painlevé, you have P6 which is regular, and the other, it's deformation of irregular systems. Okay, so we, in fact, we work in the, on the Murata list, but today I will consider only the case of P6, so no resurgence, no irregularity, no irregular equation, no Stokes coordinate. Okay, then this is the result of Jimbo Sakai, and here it's the equation of QP6. Okay, now so I need, some people are used to Q calculus, so they're unfortunately not, so I give you the basics. So I will fix, Q is fixed, it's value is it's less than one is a choice, it can be bigger, but for me it's less than one. I write sigma Q sub Q, the corresponding operator, and I will use the following theta function. The formula is would be nicer if I put plus, but it's like that. Okay, and this one satisfies this very simple, it's the basic irregular equation. It's so, it's in that sense, theta q is the analog of the exponential function. And also, I need the analog of the I need the analog of the operator x d over dx minus c. So it is this the analog of the corresponding equation is this one. So you have to show, you know, when you search for Q analog, the situation of differential objects, the answer is not unique. In general, you have many Q analogs. So Birkhoff, in his paper, he was not using this one. This is the Q analog to x to the power c, and is a more elementary Q analog, and Birkhoff used this x to the power 3, which is ramified. So we prefer to, 25 years ago, I decided to change the Birkhoff approach and to replace ramified function by meromorphic functions. For many reasons, it's better. Okay, so now I will describe how Birkhoff built the Q analog of Riemann-Hilbert. The idea is very simple. You build a local solution at zero and local solution at infinity, and then you compare. I explained at the beginning that I will describe the things for generic parameters. So I have to put to explain some genericity condition on the parameters. Okay, so you look at the spectrum. You look at the spectrum of your two matrices, constant matrix and degree mu matrices. You look at this spectrum, and you impose non-Q resonance condition. Okay, for differential equation, you impose in general translation, so it's multiplicative. And also, there is a condition of functionality at intermediate singularity. So this is function at zero at infinity, but you need functionality at intermediate singularity. And in fact, it is this relation. And then you have a Fuchs relation, like the classical Fuchs relation that expresses the fact that your fiber bundle is trivial. OK, so I will do simple things. So I will fix the exponent. I fix how it orders the exponent, and these will not move. After, it will be interesting to move the parameters, but later. Okay, so the construction of local solution is easy. I look at this constant diagonal matrix. I diagonalize this matrix. Okay, and of course, these ones are not unique, and then they can be replaced this way. Okay, and then this gamma delta, it's gauge transformation on the right side. Okay, on the left side, you have the usual gauge transformation for two different equations, but on the characterality side, the gauge transformation, the gauge freeness, will come from these two diagonal matrices. Okay, and then there is an easy lemma. You construct such matrix with convergent meromorphic, germ of meromorphic matrices and at zero at infinity. So at zero is function. At infinity is not function, but is function up to multiplication by from theta factor. Okay, so as a consequence of this lemma, you will get two fundamental matricial solutions of the systems, like that. So it's exactly like in Birkhoff, except that I replace Birkhoff's solution for these matrices. By in Birkhoff, they are ramified, here they are meromorphic. Okay, and Birkhoff used the connection matrix. He compares the solution at zero at infinity. This connection matrix lives its meromorphic on C star. and it is evidently Q invariant. So in fact, he lives on the elliptic curve. Okay, so you know the Birkhoff matrix. In the Birkhoff matrix, there is a strong mix of intermediate singularity and singularity at zero at infinity. So it's better, in some sense, to skip as much as possible the singularity at zero at infinity, and to, in fact, to replace the Birkhoff matrix by another one, that is this one. So I skip the contribution to, excuse me. I skip this contribution, this one. Okay, so I replace the ellipticity condition by an automorphic condition, this one. Okay. Then I look at the property of these matrices. Okay, and then M is holomorphic on C star, and okay. And it is very important, the determinant of M has simple zeros on a finite set of Q spirals associated to the singularity of the problem. And as explained before, you have a gauche freedom, then you can change this matrix by this transformation. Okay, so you are just led to consider the matrices possessing these three properties. Holomorphic over C star, the determinant has M0 on the basic singular spirals, and then it is automorphic. Of course, they form an affine variety. I did not like that. Then I look at the action of the gauche group. And then I quotient by the gauche group. And my character variety is this quotient. So I will try to describe it. And then you have a fundamental theorem. So I associate, I start from a system defined by the matrix A of the form shown above. On the other side, I get a matrix up to a quotient, like that. So this mapping is onto, first remark. Second remark is not injective, but the two matrices have the same image if and only if they are rationally equivalent. Equivalent by the gauche transformation for Q connections. So, I get an isomorphism of set, so it's Riemann-Hilbert for set. Okay. So now I have to describe the space of monodromy data for QP6. So it's a particular case. Mu is equal to 2, so quadratic. And we have square 2-2 matrices. So we name that the Jimbo-Sakai family. So it's a particular case of the general condition I described before. So you have to consider this space of matrices. With this condition, you impose, and then you impose some condition like before. Okay, then we can solve easily this equation. It's a particular case. And then I have to understand what are these matrix satisfying these conditions. Or I can replace this automorphic condition by this. Two, technically, it's better. And then I have to study the quotient of this set by the gauge equivalence. Okay, so I will do explicitly the computation. I look at the set of the entries of these matrices satisfying the conditions. And this is the gauge equivalence. Okay. In order to describe this question, I will use some elementary transcendental functions built with theta functions. So I look at this space of special functions, that solution of these equations. It's easy to check that the dimension of this space is k, and I get an explicit basis using this function. Then you remark this one. And also, it's easy to check that the image of this set by this map is a quadric, it's a quadric hypersurface in adequate coordinates. So I have a quadric surface. Okay. Generically, you have a map, an injective map from this set, the quadruple set of coordinates of the matrix to this point, and the gauge action induces a scalar action like that. And these linear forms, and I took the value at the singular point, these linear forms, you get linear forms, they span in a space dimension free, so you get a line. And then you have this property between this M1 and M2. This pack of product of coordinates. And then you get a first description of the character variety. You look a little bit to that geometrically. You get that it is an open affine subset of a degree 2 covering of a quadric surface ramifying over a quartic curve. The quartic curve is an intersection of a quadric surface and a quadric cylinder. In fact, it's four lines.
If you got lost, this variety is kind of algebraic on the same field to an elliptic curve, or is it?
In fact, at the end, it is an elliptic curve.
Yeah, okay.
But for the moment, I have only a rough description, so I get at the two covering. But you don't know what are the elliptic curve. At the end, it will be a copy of EQ, but at the moment, you don't know. Okay, so the preceding theorem was for us the state of the art 5 years ago, but at the beginning it was impossible to get a more precise statement. And more recently, we found a way to precise to get a better description of the character variety. And in order to do that, we introduce a new tool that we call Mano decompositions. So this was inspired by a paper of Mano, asymptotic behavior around the boundary point of the QP6 equation and its connection problem. So this, you will see it's very nice in order to describe this character variety, but we hope that it will have other applications. Because it is a basic thing. It is really a basic thing. Okay, the main idea is to perform a surgery of the systems using basic hypergeometric systems as elementary bricks. So intuitively, it corresponds to a decomposition of the initial system, E. It corresponds to decomposition of the system in decorated Q-pants. And if you look on the right side of the Betti side, we will get what we call Mano decomposition. Okay, so I recall the pant decomposition. The pants are free puncture sphere. Of course, you can decorate the pants with lace, but also with monodromies. So this is this picture. You have a four hole sphere. You can cut it in two pairs of pants. that, and then you can you get two free whole spheres, and then you can decorate the boundaries with monodromy. Okay, this is the classical picture. Okay, so the basic things is the work of Jimbo. So he explained how to cut a Penleve equation into two hypergeometric equations. So the proof is based on two different isomorphic formations of Penleve decomposition. And on the right side, you get the usual Penleve decomposition. I will go back. Okay, so Jimbo moves isomonodomically, moves these singularities, and at the end you get only one singularity. So this pair of Penleves disappear, and you get one side. And you do the same on the other sides, and you get the decomposition. And later, Mano built a Q analog of Jimbo work. So he decomposed, he made a surgery from a Q Penleve equation, he get two basic hypergeometric QP6, he get two basic Q hypergeometric equations. Okay, so it's difficult. Jimbo work is quite difficult, and Mano work is quite difficult. I will do the easy thing. I will look directly on the right side of Riemann-Hilbert, and on this right side, it's a lot simpler. Okay, perhaps I will skip this slide. Okay, so the usual business is that you block. You fix local coordinates, and you look at these freak coordinates. But unfortunately, we don't know Q analog of freak coordinates, so you have to find something different. So, in fact, it's not so difficult. We can replace the knowledge of these freak coordinates by the representation. That is a character variety for the free whole sphere. I will use that as a coordinate. And of course, you have this parameter in some sense. Of course, we will need another parameter, that is a gluing parameter between the two pairs of Penleves. Okay, so this is a classical picture. So I will explain what is a Q analog. Okay, so in order to do the Q analog, you have to replace classical hypergeometric functions by the Q analog that is basic hypergeometric function introduced by Hein at the end of 19th century. Okay, so I will use not the equation, but I will translate into systems that I call Hein systems. So for the basic bricks of the Q surgery are basic hypergeometric systems. That is, at the beginning of my lecture, I described a family of systems with a degree mu is here, mu is one. So I look at such systems. So I suppose exactly, I do exactly the same business that in the general picture. Okay, so it's mu equal 1 case. Okay, so we can apply the preceding description, but everybody knows that in the classical case, the equation is rigid, but here is the same. The equation is rigid, so the character variety is a point. But it's an interesting point. Technically, we can extend the preceding result to the resonant case. The character variety is also a point. In fact, it's written for this case, but it's general. It can be generalized easily. Okay, and then the idea is that in all cases, resonant or not, we can consider this point as a function of this T, this matrix T. Okay, and then here is the notion of Mano decomposition. I consider this fixed data. I suppose that they satisfy some genericity condition, as we described. I will take a matrix on the right side, a Birkhoff, the Van-Alf variant of Birkhoff matrix, like that. Then it is possible to cut it in two pieces. That is, there exists such a matrix in the non-resonant case and this one in the resonant case, such that you can write M as a product like that. This is a surgery on the right side. Okay. Here you have the explicit conditions, a lot of sort of non-resonance, non-irreducibility, and so on, such conditions. Okay, it's possible, in order to get a Mano decomposition, you can use Mano result, but this result is difficult, and anyway, it will give you the result only generically. But in fact, this result, if you have these generic conditions for the parameters, in fact, the theorem is true for all the matrices. So it's better to prove it directly. Anyway, it's simpler. Okay, you have some evident unicity. The only freeness is to the permutation of the coordinates. And in the second case, it's unique. Just an idea of the proof is not difficult. It's elementary algebra and using theta function and so on. Okay, so I consider the image on the elliptic curve of the xi such that you have this condition. Then you use this elliptic function. You get a ramified covering. Ramifying, the critical values are these four values. Okay, then I consider one of my matrices. And then I look at the non-zero column of this matrices, of the value of this matrix at the singular point. And then you check easily that this one is a projective invariant, is also invariant by gauge transformations. And then you get the image, the xi, the Mano decomposition, you get it using this function. You get this set up to the order. So in some sense, this one is a sort of Q analog of free coordinates. Okay, and afterwards you finish easily. There are many cases. It's not difficult. Okay, now I will explain how to use this Mano decomposition in order to parameterize the character variety. You remember this, this variety, it's two covering of a quadratic surface, but then I will parameterize it using Mano decomposition. Okay, so I start from these two values, satisfying this condition. And then I define hypergeometric matrices like that. It seems mysterious, but it's coming sort of well-known connection formula, Barnes, Mellin, Watson, for basic hypergeometric equations. Okay, so you have family of matrices parametrized by these guys, and they are function of x. Okay, now this is the two pieces. Then I have to define a gluing parameter. So the gluing parameter is very easy, such a matrix. And then I choose such a matrix, C is in C star. And then I glue these two pieces, P and Q, by D. Okay, and then it works. M satisfies a good automorphic condition. And then we can also easily verify that this M is elliptic. It's an elliptic function of Xi1 and Xi2. This is for the generic case. And for the exceptional case, it's possible to modify, to take Q logarithm and so on. And it's possible to get similar results. Okay, now you can verify with the genericity conditions that the determinant has simple zero on each set of two Q spirals and two Q spirals, and these are only zeros. Okay, and then you check that M satisfies the condition. So you parameterize a big part of the character variety. A small part is missing. I will go back later. So I will describe more precisely this parametrization. I will use these four points. So this map induces an involution on the elliptic curve. The fixed point of this involution, of course, are these four points. So the involution exchange these two coordinates of the matrix T. Okay, then you have, of course, parametrization. You have an algebraic map from the elliptic curve minus four point cross C star into the character variety. And of course, this map is not injective, but it's easy to describe what is happening. The two points admit the same image if and only if you have this condition. So you have an operation of Z2 on this set. And then I compute the quotient. First, describe the thing. I will use four charts. I choose a fixed point, alpha, beta, gamma, no matter. I send it to infinity, and so I wrote classically the elliptic curve. And then I compute the algebraic quotients. So I get an elliptic surface, and the exponential fibers correspond to this value of W. This one W is the Yukovsky map. Okay, and then I do that with other charts and we get an elliptic surface. Okay. The subsets are invariant by action of the quotient, so finally my parametrization, it starts from this elliptic surface, I remove four lines, and then I arrive into the character variety. And it is injective, it's nice parametrization. But unfortunately, this map is not surjective. And what is the missing part? It is a union of four curves. It corresponds to the exceptional case in Mano decomposition, that is the case when T is not diagonalizable. But each curve, it's easy to prove that each curve is parametrized by C. Okay, now it's not finished. The idea is to complete that into a compact elliptic surface. Then at infinity you add an elliptic curve. then you have these four points at infinity, and we think that it's possible to find a good solution blowing up at these four points. And then you remove some lines, and we hope this way to get an algebraic bijective map. That is really a good description of the character variety. And of course, you can obtain other parametrization. Is you use, if you cut, you know, you have four singularity, four spiral of singularity. So you, I have cut in two pieces, but you can choose other cutting. Here you have the classical. Here you have the classical analogs, and so it's a Q pair of points. It's a pair of points. Okay. Now some, it remains some problems and perhaps some idea of applications. Okay, the first problem is the problem of symplectic structure, and perhaps somebody could help us here. So on the left side, the things are well known. It's in the thesis of Sakai. Okay, he used an invariant volume form, C star, cos C star, like that, with poles on the vertical divisor. And in fact, it's not proved, but we think that Urieman Hilbert is analytic. So we get a volume form on the other side, but unfortunately analytic. And we think that it is rational, and it would be nice to describe it directly. Like Philippe explained you one of the preceding lectures for the differential case. Okay, and then also it's possible, it's not yet done, but we have begun. It's possible to extend our result to some other case of the Murata list. That is, species is without Stokes phenomena, but you can extend that to some case of Q.V with Stokes phenomena. And it is the idea is the same. The idea is to build a Mano decomposition for this such case. But you know, QP6, I have split it in two Hein equations. So in general, you cannot split with two Hein equations because you have to put irregular singularity. So for instance, this one will be split in Q-Kummer and Hein. This one will be split in Q-Kummer and Q-Kummer, and this one will be split in Q-Kummer plus an exon. Unfortunately, the method doesn't work for this Q-Panv equation. In that case, we don't know. Okay, so the differential analog, here you have a differential analog. Here you have the usual Pant decomposition, but it's possible to extend the decorated Pant decomposition into in the irregular case with Stokes phenomena, like that, for instance, Whittaker plus Whittaker. That is confluent hypergeometric equations. So it's possible to do Q-analogs. Q-analog is, okay, so it's Q-Kummer. So people use such decomposer, generalized span decomposition with nice applications. Okay, there are now some question to physicists here. Recently, a student sent me his master's thesis, Monodromy of Q difference equation in 3D supersymmetric gauche theory. So I quote him. So he says that it's possible to use to replace for 3D, it's possible to replace differential equations by Q difference equations. And then he says that in his thesis, he explains that it's perhaps possible to use our results on Q difference equations. In particular to compute partition functions. Okay, so he says that it's possible to use the basic materials that we built and developed during the last 25 years. Okay, so I hope that Mano decomposition will be useful in this program, and Q character varieties will be useful in this program. And in order to perform that, you need some work in progress by Oyama and Changizhang. That is all the connection formula for all the variants of basic hypergeometric equation and irregular forms. There are a lot. In particular, the notion of Mano decomposition seems strongly related to the recent work of Jimbo Nagoya Sakai in their study of the Q-conformal blocks. This one I will skip. Now, to end this lecture, about generalization and application. So it's absolutely immediate. It's easy to extend the Mano decomposition to the case of mu, the general mu like that. So you cut this one in mu disjoint subsets, and then by recursively you extend the Mano decomposition. The second problem is to try to extend the Mano decomposition in dimension strictly greater than n. This one is less evident because rigid equations are more mysterious and so on and so on and so on. And the program is to try to do such thing and to try to study relation with Q difference Galois theory and with classification problems. And in particular, I return to the what I explained at the beginning of the lecture, who like to build a wild Q fundamental group. And as I explained, we know the wild component at zero at infinity. And we hope that using Mano decomposition, perhaps it will be possible to build the Fuchsian part of the group. We have spent for 30 years with Jacques Soloa, we have tried to get this this Fuchsian part. It's a sort of it's a non-abelian class field theory. It's not so easy. We have tried to mimic the differential case, the topological case, using paths around turning around points. But it's impossible, apparently. But we hope now that using this Mano, this cut in piece, in rigid piece, is perhaps it's possible to answer the question. And of course, another very interesting problem is what happening to this business when Q goes to 1?
Absolute value of Q.
Absolute value of Q, yes. First Q goes to 1, of course, absolute value, but it's a lot more difficult. Yeah. Okay, but even the case Q goes to 1 is not so easy. So I look only for the moment, if I look only Q goes to 1, then a variant of the Birkhoff matrices converge toward a matrix which is constant on the slice of the watermelon. And this allow to recover the usual monodromy representation. You know, when Q goes to 1, you get a differential equation. And then this Birkhoff matrix, at the limit, you will recover the usual monodromy representation for the differential equation. So the trick is like that. So you look at the limit of this Birkhoff matrix, and this limit leaves on a watermelon. You have a watermelon, you have the slice, and at the limit, the matrix on each slice, the matrix, the limit is a constant. And then the jump from one slice to the other, it's a monomy. Okay, this is the end.
Questions?
I have just remarks. In fact, I don't think it's so difficult because what you do, you even describe with this torsion shifts, yeah?
Yes.
You can see the coherent shifts with two anti-Harnoff signal filtrations.
Yes, yes.
You get run to bundle and. Yeah, so the equation for break geometry and then you get one.
Yes, but the problem is to do explicit computation. No, it's not difficult. But you know, it's necessary in some sense, it's basic. So. Yeah.
But here it's also get not on just two algebraic structures on the same analytic variety, but infinitely many because you make modular invariants.
Yes.
And for elliptic difference equation, you get like something like SL3Z, parameterized various algebraic structures on the same algebraic variety.
Oh, yes.
Yeah,
yes,
so you get kind of huge family of algebraic structures on the same.
Yes. Surfaces. No, but you know, it's not difficult, but what not so easy before getting this mano, this pan decomposition.
But it's an explicit question of break geometry of vector bundles. On
yes, no, it's very elementary. It's a question of vector bundles on elliptic curves. No, it's not difficult, but it's necessary to describe such an object. It's a basic object. No, of course.
And then again, some surface with Poisson's. Yeah, and this volume element, it's quite obvious from as it's algebraic, symplectic structure is algebraic, it's completely obvious from a certain perspective.
Okay, so you can explain it. Well, thank you very much.
For special values of these parameters, capital A, B, C, D, that you have, this Q character variety is independently known to be spherical double affine Hecke algebra. That's a theorem of a Blomkamp. Yes. Is it obviously compatible with...
I don't know. For special values?
Yeah, there is a one-dimensional family.
Yes.